So next, we have, how do you weigh the social balances of equipping AI with human-like intelligence? And how does your work aim to integrate AI into society in a positive way? Ultimately, I'm an optimist. I think that there is a positive future for AI integrating into society. I have had the dream since childhood of, you know, robots that are human-like, that interact with us. I really think there can be a positive and valuable future with powerful AI systems living alongside us. However, it is definitely true that there are a lot of ways that this could go wrong. So my own current approach to dealing with that kind of trade-off is to say, I want to focus on understanding these systems, not necessarily being the one who's going to deploy and make the big system. So I get to kind of step back and just act as a scientist and try to understand, what are the principles of intelligence? How do current AI systems work? What are they good at? What are they not good at? And that's a position that I quite enjoy and I'm quite comfortable with, because I think that understanding these things and developing the science of these things is just going to pay off for society. It will allow us to make good choices about how to integrate them into the world. But that is going to be a hard policy decision later on in the future. What do you see as the key challenges for generative video models, and what other emerging trends in generative AI pique my interest? Yeah, generative video models are really, really cool. They're the current thing that's taking off. So there's maybe two big challenges here. The first challenge is that videos are really big. They are a lot of frames. So imagine if it's hard to make a single image, well, a video is like thousands of frames, thousands of images. So the amount of compute and the amount of memory and resources required to generate a video is just a lot more than to generate a single photo. So we're going to have to make these systems more efficient. That's one problem. The other hard thing about video generation is physical accuracy and physical consistency. So if you've ever seen one of these video generative models, like the Sora model maybe from OpenAI, what you might have noticed is it kind of looks like a dream. It looks like you're in some dream world where objects are just kind of popping in and out of existence. The geometry changes when the camera pans around and it returns to where it started. You might have entirely new content. There's a video I saw of a chair that's kind of morphing out of the sand on a beach and forming the legs, and everything is a bit dreamlike and physically unrealistic. These things are definitely getting better, but they're not quite there in terms of their physical accuracy. And that's one of the big challenges that people are working on now. There's one other part to that question, so let me go to this. What generative AI methods are piquing my interest beyond videos? And the one that I'm really excited about is what is called generative world models. So generative world models are methods that try to make not just like a video or an image, but a whole world, a whole simulation of the world. So that means something that I can, you know, step into and interact with, like a video game. I can intervene and throw an object and it will bounce against the geometry in this world. So think of like a game or a simulation engine. And people are trying to make generative models where I could like type in text and it will generate this whole world for me. I'd say, make me a video game on Mars where I can jump on different platforms and do a backflip. And then it just makes that game for you. So this is something that's not quite available yet, but is coming very quickly. And I'm excited about it, not just because it could be used to make fun video games, but actually because it's like a new way of doing simulation. And simulation has a fundamental role in engineering and in science. We often use simulation to test out ideas and to make decisions. If I have a generative simulation, I can do that same type of simulation-based engineering in my generative model. So one thing that we've been doing recently is trying to train and develop robots in simulation, and then deploy the robots in the world. So the robot can interact with the simulation, it's safe, they're not going to break anything. They can maybe drive as a self-driving car in a simulation, it's okay if they get into a crash in the simulation, and they can learn from their mistakes how to behave in a safer way. And then we deploy that technology into the world. So previously, people used classical physics simulations of the world. And now what is happening is we're starting to use generative models as our simulation engine. We recently have a project which we call Lucid Sim, which tries to use generative AI as the simulation engine for training robots. Can you walk us through the process of how an AI system learns to understand images? So there are kind of two different ways that you currently can train an AI to understand images. One way is via generative AI, via generative modeling. So the basic idea here is that if I have a model that can make images, then it must have understood something about the visual world, right? It's kind of like this Feynman quote, what I can't create, I don't understand. And, you know, presumably what I can create, I do better understand. So if a model has been trained to be able to make images and videos and worlds, then it must understand something about the world. And indeed, that's what we see happening. Some of the current really effective image processing and image understanding algorithms work by just trying to generate visual content. And then by generating the content, they learn how to interpret the content as well. The other way that current systems learn to process and understand images is what I alluded to before, which is self-supervised learning, where you take an image and you just try to predict some property of the image from some other property. So you try to predict missing pixels from observed pixels, or imagine a video. You might try to predict what is the next frame going to be given the previous frame. If you can make these types of predictions, you must understand something about the world around you. If I can predict what I'll see in the future, I must have an understanding of how objects move, the idea that a ball travels in a parabola when I throw it. So these types of understanding come out of making predictions, and that's the second way of doing visual understanding. How is your group working toward improving the quality and quantity of synthetic data to train generative AI models? And how can this type of data teach robots to learn visually from their errors? Yeah, I'm really excited about the prospect of using synthetic data from generative models to improve AI systems. This is an area where there's actually a lot of confusion right now, and there's a lot of debate about when synthetic data can be useful or not useful. So one thing that people worry about is that if the internet just becomes polluted with a lot of output from language models and just fake data, then maybe this is going to, we're going to lose touch with reality. And the future models that are trained on that will just get worse and worse and worse. And there are some cases in which that might happen, and we have to watch out for that. But what I'm working on and what I'm a lot more excited about is kind of the optimistic outlook that models can potentially make synthetic data that's actually better than the real data that trained the model in the first place. Like, synthetic data can be better than real data. And there are various ways in which that can happen. And we're basically working on algorithms that try to achieve that. So for example, I might have a generative model that can be steered or intervened on. Like, a human can actually go in and change the parameters of the model to steer it to make data that is more positive or more useful for some kind of downstream task. There are methods like one called reinforcement learning from human feedback that essentially do that. They take a model and they kind of steer it toward human preferences of what is considered to be better data. So this is just one example of how you can make synthetic data that is better than real data. And I think that there's just a really interesting future along those lines. The question was also asking about how we're using this for robotics. And that goes back to this Lucid Sim project that I talked about in the previous answer, where we are trying to create world models that in which you can train a robot. So it's a simulation augmented with generative models and generative AI that can create all types of diverse content and imagine all types of different scenarios, so that if I train my robot in that world, it will become robust and competent in all of these different scenarios. So this is a place where generative models and synthetic data can teach our next generation of AI systems. Looking ahead to the next 10 years, what do you envision next for AI and image processing? I really think that the future of AI is much more going to be about the integration of all of our sensory modalities and all of our other problems in AI into a more kind of holistic approach, this embodied intelligence approach, this human-like agent that I mentioned at the beginning. So I'm not sure that image processing as like a sub-area of AI will be the most exciting thing in the future. I think it's more about how you integrate images and sounds and touch signals, all the modalities together. You add language to the pipeline. you get the field of natural language processing to talk to the field of computer vision, to talk to the field of robotics. So to me, the future of image processing and computer vision is more about integration with other areas of AI. And I think we're at a time when that is going to be really effective. So the last question is, are multimodal world models possible? Kind of combining discriminative, generative, and perceptual understanding in a single model. Okay, this is perfect because this follows exactly on my previous response. I think, yes, this is the exciting future, is these multimodal systems and these multi-model systems as well, where there's different models all interacting, all becoming more and more unified in how they understand the world, and thereby becoming more effective and accurate and robust. So there's a lot of work in this area of combining a vision system with a language system, deploying that on a robot, potentially. And I think it's just a really interesting area right now. All of these different ways of modeling the world, like the way that a language model models the world and the way that a vision model models the world, are becoming more and more alike in a measurable way. So the representations inside the latest language models and the representations inside the latest vision models are becoming more alike in their mathematical properties. So we have this idea that we call the Platonic representation hypothesis, that there's maybe some ultimate like unified representation, this Platonic entity, and all of these different modalities and sensors and problems are projections and reflections of that underlying central thing. And we really want to find that thing, and that will be a way of unifying these different parts of AI, these different sensory processes, into a common framework, and that's one of our ongoing projects. That's it for the questions. It was really fun to get a chance to answer them and think about these really interesting topics. So thank you for taking the time, and I'll see you in the next one.